Good morning. Good morning. Greetings to you in the name of the Lord. It's great to see you all here this morning. Welcome to those of you who are viewing our service via the internet, either our YouTube or Facebook pages. Glad to have you as well, and hope that we can see you live and in person at some point. It is Labor Day weekend, and so need to mention that the church office will be closed tomorrow in observance of the federal holiday. If you need to get a hold of me, of course, I'm still always available. Couple of things going on that I want to mention this morning. One is that the Women's Association meets this Wednesday, and they'll be doing that, where are they doing that? In the main streets. Yeah, sure enough, in the main streets, Sarah. Thank you, Glenda. At 1 o'clock, masks and social distancing, of course, is part of that. Nevertheless, it is an opportunity to get together, and so that's for all the women of the church. There are a variety of needs out there. Under the announcements in the bulletin, you can see what several of them are in connection with high school, with community blessing, with Michael Dorich and Josh Hathi. Operation Christmas Child will be starting soon. We're going to try and get it underway a bit early this year. And Shawnee Hills Christian Academy is in need of an advanced math teacher, someone who can teach advanced algebra. To my mind, that means a person who has penetrated the mysteries of the universe. Okay. Algebra was a mystery to me in high school, and it still is. So if you are a really smart person or just can teach advanced algebra, give Bonnie a call. And that's a volunteer position, but it's not 4 days a week all day or anything like that. So any help you could give her there would be appreciated. Take note of the other items in the bulletin, and let's worship the Lord.
Good morning. Happy Labor Day weekend. I guess it's not Labor Day yet, but so Please join me for the call to worship. The call to worship this morning is from Psalm 67. We give thanks to the Lord with our whole heart. You have rebuked the nations. The Lord is the stronghold for those oppressed. And those who know your name put their trust in you. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come today to seek you. We come to seek you and your presence through your Spirit. God, we come to worship your Son, whom you have given as heir of all things. God, we come today to honor and glorify you, to praise your name above all things, to bring you glory above all things. God, we pray that today that as we sing, that our hearts would make a joyful noise to you. God, that we would be in a spirit of worship as we sing your praises. God, we pray that as we hear your word, that we would not only listen with our ears, but God, with our hearts, that it would penetrate to bone and to marrow, God, to lead us into to all godliness and to conform us into the image of your Son. And we ask that in Christ's name. Amen.
Good morning. I guess I'm supposed to say happy Labor Day weekend like everybody else says. I mean, no, it's just kidding. So what a beautiful day to worship the Lord in song. If you're joining us here in the sanctuary or on Facebook or YouTube, welcome. And our first and opening hymn, is number 59, All Creatures of Our God and King.
Others take your part. Oh, sing. past your care. Oh, praise him. Oh, praise him. Alleluia. 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 Let all things their Creator bless and worship him in humbleness. Oh, praise him. Alleluia. Praise, praise the Father, praise the Son, and praise the Spirit, three in one. Oh, praise him. Oh, praise him. Alleluia. Alleluia. Alleluia.
Join me in prayer again. God of all grace and all mercy, God who deserves all praise, come before you this morning as you are the one who hears and you are the one who answers prayer. And God, today we lift up those in our congregation who are in need of healing, who are in need of strength, in need of grace. God, those who are in need of your presence. God, we think of Zach Cohen and Cassie and their family as Zach is recovering from surgery. So he's recovering from that. And God, as he comes home, maybe this week, we pray that you would give them strength and grace for the transition ahead. God, that you would be that ever-present help, the one who would give peace, the one who would give comfort, God, the one who would give those of us around them the ability to see their need. God, we pray for those others who have in our congregation who have had long-term issues, God, Donna and Bruce Bible, George and Linda Warren, God, we pray that you will continue to strengthen, you will continue to give the doctors wisdom and knowledge as they move forward. God, we also pray for the leaders of our congregation. We pray this morning for our pastor. We pray, first of all, that as he brings your message to us, God, that you would anoint his words, God, that you would give him strength and clarity. God, that you would bless him in that way. God, we pray for our elders. We pray for wisdom and knowledge. We pray, God, that you would help us to lead in a manner and shepherd in a manner that honors and glorifies you above all things. God, we pray for our local leaders, our mayors, God, our county officials, that as we deal with this pandemic and decisions that must come, God, we pray that you would give wisdom there, that you would give clarity. God, we pray the same for our state officials. We pray the same for our national officials, God, that you would help them to lead in righteousness, that God, that you would give them the ability to see truth, and God, that you would help them to do not what's best for them, but what's best for the people that you have entrusted to them. And God, together, as we have joined, we pray the prayer that your Son has taught us as we pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this daily bread and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Morning. Well, it happened again. I looked at the bulletin and surprise that I'm supposed to be doing this. I just found that, figured it out this morning. So I really got to start reading the bulletin a little more, a little sooner. I know, but our Old Testament reading today comes from the book of Exodus, chapter 8, verses 20 through chapter 9, verse 7. It's about the fourth and the fifth plagues. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Rise up early in the morning and present yourself to Pharaoh as he goes out to the water, and say to him, 'Thus saith, says the Lord, let my people go that they may serve me. Or else if you will not let my people go, behold, I will send swarms of flies on you and your servants and your people and into your houses. And the houses of the Egyptians shall be filled with swarms of flies and also the ground on which they stand. But on that day, I will set apart the land of Goshen where my people dwell so that no swarms of flies shall be there, that you may know that I am the Lord in the midst of the earth. Thus I will put a division between my people and your people. Tomorrow this sign shall happen.' And the Lord did so. There came great swarms of flies into the house of Pharaoh and into his servants' houses. Throughout all the land of Egypt, the land was ruined by the swarms of flies. Then Pharaoh called Moses and Aaron and said, 'Go sacrifice to your God within the land.' But Moses said, 'It would not be right to do so, for the offerings we shall sacrifice to the Lord our God are an abomination to the Egyptians. If we sacrifice offerings abominable to the Egyptians before their eyes, will they not stone us? We must go 3 days' journey into the wilderness and sacrifice to the Lord our God as he tells us.' So Pharaoh said, 'I will let you go to sacrifice to the Lord your God in the wilderness, only you must not go very far away. Plead for me.' Then Moses said, 'Behold, I am going out from you, and I will plead with the Lord that the swarms of flies may depart from Pharaoh, from his servants, and from his people tomorrow. Only let not Pharaoh cheat again by not letting the people go to sacrifice to the Lord.' So Moses went out from Pharaoh and prayed to the Lord, and the Lord did as Moses asked and removed the swarms of flies from Pharaoh, from his servants, and from his people. Not one remained. But Pharaoh hardened his heart this time also and did not let the people go. Then the Lord said to Moses, 'Go into Pharaoh and say to him, Thus says the Lord, the God of the Hebrews, let my people go that they may serve me. For if you refuse to let them go and still hold them, behold, the hand of the Lord will fall with a very severe plague upon your livestock that are in the field, the horses, the donkeys, the camels, the herds, and the flocks. But the Lord will make a distinction between the livestock of Israel and the livestock of Egypt, so that nothing of all that belongs to the people of Israel shall die.' And the Lord set a time, saying, 'Tomorrow the Lord will do this thing in the land.' And the next day the Lord did this thing. All the livestock of the Egyptians died, but not one of the livestock of the people of Israel died. And Pharaoh sent, and behold, not one of the livestock of Israel was dead, but the heart of Pharaoh was hardened, and he did not let the people go." This is God's word.
Please stand for the reading of the gospel, which comes to us this morning from the gospel according to Matthew, chapter 18, verses 15 to 20. Jesus said, If your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he listens to you, you have gained your brother. But if he does not listen, take one or two others along with you, that every charge may be established by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If he refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if he refuses to listen even to the church, let him be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly, I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Again, I say to you, if two of you agree on earth about anything they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, there am I among them. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Please be seated. After singing a song, a hymn like All Creatures of Our God and King, it's difficult to then turn to the plagues of Egypt and see the frogs and the gnats and the flies and think, all creatures? Yes, all creatures serve him in one way or another. And sad to say, simply by virtue of the fact that we don't always serve him as we ought, sometimes even those creatures serve him in a way that may glorify him, but surely annoys the daylights out of us. Last week's message, I might begin by saying, seemed to strike a chord with some people. I had a number of people contact me this week to tell me that they had sighted frogs on their property. They asked if they should be worried, and I said, well, if you find them in the bathroom or in the oven, then maybe you should. Otherwise, they're just frogs. Well, we come this morning to the fourth plague as well as the fifth. I'm going to do both of those this morning. And the fourth plague, according to the English translation, is plague of flies. As I'll explain in a moment, it's not quite that simple. This one starts out the same way as the previous ones, with God telling Moses to go to Pharaoh and demand that Israel be released. And the demand is that they be let go in order to serve him, or, according to verse 21, or else, if you will not let my people go, I will send swarms of flies on the king and his family and servants and in houses and across lands throughout Egypt. He says, if you will not let Israel go, as a way of recognizing this is still Pharaoh's decision. This is still Pharaoh operating on the basis of his assumptions, his presuppositions, his beliefs, and it is still going to be his will, Pharaoh's will, that's going to be done in making that decision. God is not going to force him to do what he otherwise doesn't want to do. All right? So I want to continue to hit that because that's one of the things that's most misunderstood about the way that God operates. He does not force us to sin, ever, ever. God will allow us to do what we want to do. If that's sinful, that's our problem. Occasionally, I think, God will strengthen our resolve to do so if it serves his purposes. But he's not going to impose a sinful mindset or attitude or desire on us where that was not already present. Okay, so that's the if. Now, if he does decide that way, the result will be swarms of flies. Now, I've been trying, as I mentioned last week, to make this as graphic as I can, given the setting, because we need to really recognize these are not just minor annoyances. These are not just inconveniences. When these are referred to as plagues, they really were. Now, I would guess nobody here likes flies. Would that be fair? Anybody like want to say, yeah, I like flies. They're my friends. You know, I collect them by the dozens. No, nobody's going to say that. Flies are annoying. As a matter of fact, most animals, as well as people, consider flies to be annoying, right? Autumn and Brooke, when your horses are dealing with flies, are they happy about it? No, they want to get rid of them. Well, there's a problem. We're not talking about house flies here. Despite the fact that that's the word that's used, that flies is the word that's used here in English, what you need to think more in terms of are horse flies, flying beetles. Okay, you need to think about biters. All right, these are not the kind of flies that annoy you by buzzing in front of your face. These are the kind of flies that bite. And if you are bitten by enough of them, it gets to be really painful, and it even can be life-threatening. Those are the kinds of flies we're talking about here. And of course, we're talking about swarms of them. We're not talking about the one house fly that gets in when you open the back porch door and who then proceeds to drive you crazy for the next 3 days until dies, or you squash it, one or the other. We're talking about being surrounded by big biting horse flies, beetles, things like that. And if that sounds grotesque, it should, because that's what it was. And that was a particularly meant to be a jab at the religion of the Egyptians. When God speaks to us, he frequently does so in a way that has as its purpose the puncturing of our idols, right? In Egyptian religion, the beetle was given an almost sacred position. You've heard of the scarab. For reasons that I don't understand, I wouldn't be surprised if there were at least some Egyptians who didn't get it either. For some reason, the beetle, like the jackal, for instance, another unpleasant animal that for whatever reason was treated as a divinity in ancient Egypt, was sacred. And so for them to be plagued by, among other things, the beetles that they worshiped, that was God's way of turning their own idols against them, which, of course, God is frequently wont to do. You think about some of the idols that we, and at times, may even if unconsciously worship, and you realize those idols will sometimes turn on us, whether that might be power or wealth or health or whatever it might be that we make into something more than what it is, it can turn on us. And sometimes it can turn on us in an instant. We've seen pictures or you've heard stories about stockbrokers who jumped out of windows on Wall Street on October 24th, I think it was, 1929, with the crash of the stock market and the beginning of the Great Depression. Some of those stories are apocryphal, but there's no question there were people in the financial sector who took their own lives as a result of the events, not just of that day, but of the days and weeks and months and years that followed. And that was an example of our idols turning on us. The wealth that had become so central to American culture in the 1920s, the roaring 20s that were called that, not just because of jazz and bathtub gin, but were called that because of incredible economic growth and the growth of wealth, particularly at the upper ends of the economic ladder, turned on them. And for some people, they just couldn't deal with that. Marianne had a had an uncle who lost everything in the Depression and started drinking. And she asked her grandmother, who was this uncle's sister, asked him once when she asked him this. She asked her grandmother this in the late 70s. She asked, "When was the last time you saw your brother sober?" And she said, "I think it was 1930. That's a long time to react to a loss. Of course, there were other factors involved, certainly, but I mean, that's what happens when our idols turn on us, and that's what happened when the Beatles turned on the Egyptians. They suddenly realized we're in a mess of trouble here. But this particular plague was different from the others, in that God specifically said, and Moses told Pharaoh, "I'm going to protect Israel against this." On verse 22, in verse 22, Exodus says, "On that day, I will set apart the land of Goshen in northeastern Egypt, where my people dwell, so that no swarms of flies shall be there, that you may know that I am the Lord in the midst of the earth." This is his way of saying, I can protect my people when I want to. And that's my purpose right here. It's to let you know I have made a division between those who are my people, those who believe in me, those who are my followers, and those of you who reject me. I'm going to make that distinction. Now, we typically assume, I think, I know I generally have before starting to get in depth into Exodus, that the plague of the bloody Nile and the frogs and the gnats, Israel was protected against those as well. But in fact, the text doesn't say that. Israel may well have suffered right along with the Egyptians with those, specifically in order for God to then make this distinction. Okay, you may think, he's saying, you may think that as awful as this has been, these first three plagues, you may think, well, this is just natural occurrences. Okay, for some reason, the frogs decided to invade. For some reason, you know, all the gnats got Viagra or something, and so they've multiplied incredibly, and they're everywhere, and they've affected the Israelites as well as the Egyptians. That I think is probably even more likely, because it doesn't say that they were protected, and he does say here, I'm going to make sure that Israel isn't touched by these. So, once again, Pharaoh refuses to let them go, as has been the case all along. And so verse 24 then tells us, there came great swarms of flies into the house of Pharaoh and into his servants' houses throughout all the land of Egypt. The land was ruined by the swarms of flies. We don't think of flies as ruining things, but in fact, if you think about these as particularly aggressive and biting flies, the ruination becomes pretty clear. These are creatures that would be injuring people and animals and devouring plants. This was not just annoying or irritating or inconvenient. This was life-threatening. And so Pharaoh responds differently from the way he had responded previously. He says to Moses and Aaron, go, sacrifice to your God within the land. Which is another way of saying, stay put right where you are and go ahead and practice your religion. Well, Moses and Aaron are not going to put up with that. And they're not going to put up with it for a very reasonable, practical reason. The offerings we shall sacrifice to the Lord are an abomination to the Egyptians. Among other things, the plan was to sacrifice animals that the Egyptians would have considered it sacrilegious for them to sacrifice. If we sacrifice offerings abominable to the Egyptians before their eyes, will they not stone us? How can you argue with that? You know, do we ever get upset when we see blasphemy or sacrilege right in front of our eyes? Have you all seen the statue of Baphomet, which was set up? I want to say it was on the lawn in front of the state capital of Michigan. Arkansas? Okay, might be. Anyway, it was set up in front of the state capitol. And the rationale, church-state law being applied, was that if you can set up some kind of Christian memorial or a nativity scene, then you should be able to set up a statue of Baphomet, who is a satanic figure, usually associated with Canaanite gods. And it was done, of course, by the Church of Satan, which may be a joke, but which still makes the blood boil. I don't know about you, seeing that set up didn't do anything for me. I don't know that I wanted to stone those folks. I did want to shake them by the lapels and say, "You have any clue what you're doing here? What kind of things you're opening yourself up to?" But anyway, the point that Moses and Aaron make to Pharaoh makes perfect sense. If they do something that the Egyptians consider blasphemous or sacrilegious, obviously they're going to take issue with that, and the Hebrews will suffer for it. So, verse 28, Pharaoh said, "I will let you go sacrifice to the Lord your God in the wilderness, only you must not go very far away." I love that. I love that. You can go outside the border, right? But don't go very far. We wouldn't want you to think that you're sneaking off. I get the picture here of children who in public places are told by their parents to stay close, and when their parents are looking at something else, you know, they're doing this. How far can I get away without them noticing? that's the picture I get when I see this. Moses doesn't say anything to that. The fact is, he knows he's going to come back to the demand that they go to Sinai, because that's where they're supposed to go. But he says, "All right, okay, I'm going to go, and I'm going to plead with God that the swarms of flies may depart from you." But he says in verse 29, "Let's not have any of that nonsense that we had before." You'll remember that with the plague of frogs, Pharaoh told them that he would let them go, and then he reneged, changed his mind once the incentive to act was gone. And so Moses says, "We're watching you, okay? Don't cheat us. Don't lie to us this time." So he went, he prayed to the Lord, he got what Pharaoh asked, the swarms of flies were removed. Verse 32 says, "But Pharaoh hardened his heart this time also." Because Pharaoh is human, okay, and Pharaoh is a politician. And you put those two things together, and what you've got is a person who responds to incentive. Okay, that's actually, I mean, I pick on politicians, but the truth of the matter is all people operate on the basis of incentive to at least some extent. That's the whole foundation for modern economics, is the incentives that people respond to or don't respond to or respond badly to. Okay. Well, here, Pharaoh responds to an incentive and he says he's going to let them go. And then as soon as the incentive is removed, he defaults right back to his previous position. His previous position, of course, being, no, I don't think so. I think you're too valuable here, and I don't care about either your freedom or your God, and so we're just going to keep you right here. Incentives. We not only need to recognize when we're responding to idols, we need to recognize when we're responding to ungodly incentives too, because those are placed in front of us all the time. Well, the fifth plague we're going to deal with real quickly. The fifth plague is that the livestock of Egypt die. Unlike Hindus, ancient Egyptians did not worship cows, so they no doubt had cattle. They undoubtedly had sheep, and those are the things that are affected. As bad as the flies were, this ratchets things up a bit, because now death has come. This is the first time that we're told that anything dies as a result of one of the plagues. And I think there's probably one of those intentional or perhaps unintentional but directed by the Spirit things going on here, in that this is the fifth plague. This is the end of the first half. Here you have animals die. Later on, we see people die. But we'll stick with the animals for the time being. The same demand, of course, is made for Pharaoh to let Israel go, and the threat is a significant one. The death of animals upon whom the Egyptians depended not just for food, but labor as well. Okay. They would have used camels, yes, for some labor. They would have used horses, but they probably also used bulls and oxen. For labor, and those were all going to be affected. And once again, as in the previous plague, according to verse 6, that same distinction was made between Israel and Egypt. All the livestock of the Egyptians died, but not one of the livestock of the people of Israel died. Again, direct parallel between that and the later death of the firstborn. But once again, as part of a broken record, Pharaoh is unmoved. Pharaoh sent, and behold, not one of the livestock of Israel was dead. He found out that, in fact, God had done exactly what he said he was going to do. He killed the Egyptians' livestock. He left that of the Israelites. Completely inexplicable, except as a matter of divine intervention, and yet the heart of Pharaoh was hardened and he did not let the people go. So once again, exactly the same result. What Pharaoh had decided from the beginning, he was still sticking to. And at least part of the reason, I suspect, was that even with the frogs in his bed and the horse flies and beetles biting him, Pharaoh has not yet really felt the sting of what God has for him. But he would feel it, of course, and when he did, things would change. Let's pray. Father, as difficult as it is to read these stories of the plagues, we recognize your righteousness and your goodness, and yes, even your mercy at work in them. Even when you send plagues upon people, you do so for the purpose of changing their hearts and minds. And that there are people who do not do so is sad. But for those of us who have had our minds changed, we see your purposes at work. And we celebrate them, because in the end, it was liberation, it was deliverance, it was salvation for Israel, and ultimately through your Son, for all your people. We thank you, Father, and we do so in Jesus' name. Amen. As we prepare to come to the table, I'd ask you to turn in your bulletin to the Apostles' Creed. May we respond to the word that we have heard with this profession of faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. And now, again, as our part of our preparation for coming to the table of the Lord, let us pray, offering our confession to the Lord and hearing his word of grace. Let us pray. Hear these words of grace as we have them from the Apostle John. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. In Christ's name, we are a forgiven people. Amen. Brothers and sisters, we are invited to come together around this table as those who belong to the household of Christ, who in our baptized lives live out the death and resurrection of Jesus, the family of the reborn and the reconciled who inhabit a universe of grace. If you are of his household, then come to his table. Let us pray. We give you thanks, O God, through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, whom you have sent in these last times as Savior and Redeemer and messenger of your will. He is your word, inseparable from you, through whom you made all things and in whom you take delight. You sent him from heaven into the Virgin's womb, where he was conceived and took flesh. Born of Mary by the power of the Holy Spirit, he was revealed as your Son. In fulfillment of your will, he stretched out his hands in suffering to release from suffering those who placed their trust in him, and so won for you a holy people. He freely accepted the death to which he was handed over in order to destroy death and to shatter the chains of the evil one, to trample underfoot the powers of hell and to lead the righteous into light, to fix the boundaries of death and to manifest the resurrection in which we shall all participate. Remembering, therefore, his death and resurrection, we set before you this bread and cup, thankful that you've counted us worthy through Christ to stand in your presence and serve you as your priestly people. We ask you to send your Holy Spirit upon this blessed sacrament. Gather into one all who share these holy mysteries, filling them with the Holy Spirit and confirming their faith in the truth, that together we may praise you and give you glory through your servant, Jesus Christ. For through him, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty Father, with the Holy Spirit and the Holy Church, now and forever. Amen. Brothers and sisters, on the night our Lord was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. Do this in remembrance of me." Brothers and sisters, the body of Christ broken for us. After the supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink of this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
Brothers and sisters, the blood of Christ poured out for us. Let us pray. Lord God, in gratitude for this moment, this meal, this fellowship, we give ourselves to you. Send us out to live as changed people because we have shared the living bread and cannot remain the same. Ask much of us, expect much of us, enable much by us. Encourage many through us. May we live to your glory, both as inhabitants of earth and citizens of the commonwealth of heaven, for Christ's sake. Amen.
Our closing hymn this morning is hymn number 99, Jesus, What a Friend for Sinners. We'll be singing the first, second, and fifth verses.
Jesus, what a friend for sinners. Jesus, lover of my soul. Hands may fail me, foes assail me. He, my Savior, makes me whole. Alleluia, what a Savior. Alleluia, what a friend. Saving, helping, keeping, loving, he is with me to the end. Jesus, what a strength in weakness. Let me hide myself in him. Tempted, tried, and sometimes failing, he my strength, my victory wins. Alleluia, what a Savior. Alleluia, what a friend. Saving, helping, keeping, loving, he is with me to the end. Jesus, I do now receive him. More than all, in him I find. He hath granted me forgiveness. I am his, and he is mine. Alleluia, what a Savior. Alleluia, what a friend. Saving, helping, keeping, loving, he is with me to the end.
And now as you depart, receive this benediction from the Lord. May the God of all grace, who has saved us from all the world's plagues and made us children of his, go with us and be seen at work in us and through us, both now and forever. Amen.
Yeah.